us not to hinder such, for theirs is the kingdom. Praise the Lord as you meditate on these issues. We would once again like to recognize the participation of our friends in the various downlink sites around the world. In the Indian subcontinent, we are glad that Mumbai, Chennai, you are with us tonight. In Malawi, Kanjeza and Kawale churches, we thank the Lord that you've chosen to be a host to a host of people there. In Zambia, the homes of Jay Longo in Livingstone, Jay Kaite in Lusaka, keep on the good work, my brothers. In Zimbabwe, Kwe Kwe, Nkai, keep up the good job. In Botswana, Maun, Kasane, Gaborone Central, Kanye, Molepolole, keep on. Swaziland, Lesotho, Angola, welcome on board. South Africa, my dear friends in Kenya, Keroke, Homa Bay, Kakamega, Ethiopia, you're welcome. We are overjoyed with the coming aboard of two sites in Tanzania. The first one is in Mererani, the home of Tanzanite, and the second one is Chome, on Mpare Mountains, without forgetting sites such as those that are found in Kigoma and Mbeya with the Tukuyu. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! God is good all the time. May I now call on my friend and fellow servant in the vineyard of the Lord, Dr. Whitson Mwamakamba, who serves as the publishing director to the Eastern African Division, to lead us to God's throne room as we stand in prayer. Dr. Mwamakamba.
Father God in heaven, we want to thank you so much tonight for this Mwanza satellite evangelism. We pray, Father, that may you bless each individual gathered here. We can see the stadium is fully packed. Over 40,000 people gathered here, Father. We pray that, Lord, may you bless them. Father, we pray that may you bless this country, that peace may continue so that many people may hear your voice. And also, Father, we'd like to pray for the president of this country, President Mkapa, his cabinet, and all the members of the parliament, and everyone who contributes to the peace of this country. Now, Father, time has come when you would like to pray for the preacher. May you touch his brain cells. May you touch his lips, that the words may reach each individual here. Loosen our fibers in our bodies, that we may be able to receive your word. Thank you, Father, for hearing our prayer. For we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Glad to be here again. Another beautiful night in Mwanza.
We would like to welcome you tonight. Tonight we have a very special feature. With us we have some of the crew from a church building site that is happening here in Mwanza, Tanzania. So at this time we would like to ask them a few questions about the project they're working on. First of all, we'll talk to Josh. Josh, where do you call home?
I grew up in Zambia, but now I live in Nairobi, and that's home for me now.
All right. Tell us a little about the church location. Where is it here in reference to the city, in case anyone wanted to find it?
It's about 5 kilometers to the east, in a little village called Igoma.
Okay, all right. How big is your team that came over either from the States or here locally or from other countries around the country we're in now?
We've got about 22 people that are helping us there, and they're doing a real good job.
All right, thanks, Josh. Lawrence, how about you, friend? You didn't come quite as far for this, I guess. Where are you from?
I'm from Kenya.
Okay, well, pretty much the same location, I guess. Now, the church seem, from when we were out there visiting, to be larger than many of the churches we've seen here. How big is the dimensions of the church?
The dimension of the church is 32 feet by 80 feet.
Okay, and then how many people do you expect that to seat?
I hope it can accommodate as far as 400 people seated.
Okay, so 400 people, and what denomination of church is it?
That is obviously Seventh-day Adventist.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Lawrence.
Darren, we have a couple of students with us also. I'm going to start with Mercedes. Mercedes, why don't you tell us where you're from?
I'm from Colorado, USA.
And what's the high school that you go to there?
Oh, I go to Mile High Academy.
Great. Now, why don't you tell us a little bit of background on why you decided to come on this trip?
Well, I wanted to go get closer to God, and it seemed like an adventure and away from America, I guess.
Those are good answers. Now, how did you raise the money? Tell us a little bit about that.
Oh, I asked a lot of friends and church members for money, and they offered it in a lot, donations.
Good. Praise the Lord. I know that's a matter of prayer, but it's an important one. Thanks so much. We've also got Stella here with us. Stella, why don't you tell us where you're from?
I'm from Denver, Colorado also.
Same high school?
Yeah, same high school, Mile High Academy.
Good. Now, when we were out there a couple of nights ago, Stella, or a couple of days ago, rather, we saw that you guys were organizing a vacation Bible school. Was that planned?
It wasn't planned, actually. When we came, we just saw these kids hanging around. They were just watching us, and Jerry Brodus, our female sponsor, came up with this great idea of starting a vacation Bible school, and we all just went along with it, and the first day we started it, there were about 80 kids, and we just did skits from the Bible, and today there were like 150 kids, so more kids keep coming, and we did art crafts and stuff like that, and they really enjoyed it, and so I'm having fun with it.
Wow, praise the Lord. That's a great ministry, children's ministry.
All
thanks,
right.
Stella.
Excellent. What a sacrifice. Okay, we got one more person. Donnie, where are you from?
I'm from Brighton, Colorado. In the United States.
Okay, sorry about that. You bet. Now tell me, what is a typical day like at the construction site? When do you get up and some of those things?
Well, we get up about 6 o'clock in the morning and go have breakfast at the hotel. Then we drive out to the site, which takes us about a half an hour, and it's a real bumpy ride. And after we get there, we have a little worship, and then we decide what we're going to do, and we work till noon, have dinner, and work till we're tired and dusty and dirty, and go home and take a bath.
All right, awesome. Thank you, Donnie. Thank you, crew. We want to thank them for coming out tonight. They're working hard out there each and every day. And this church is coming up, a church just out in the middle of beautiful countryside that wasn't there before this week, and now it's going up and it's becoming strong for the people that live out there. We have a short clip that we want to show you at this time that will show you some of the work that is going on out there. And we just wanted to encourage all of you that may have worked in building projects or may be currently working on them. We hope this video will be a bit of an encouragement to you as well. Thank you very much.
Denver, Colorado, in the United States is here in Mwanza to help build a church for the local congregation.
Construction is underway and right on schedule as the young people work hard together with experienced hands.
Vacation Bible School program being provided. Such precious faces. The children are learning about the Bible as they see the love and dedication that the young missionaries have for them.
It is very exciting to see both physical and spiritual foundations being laid here in Mwanza.
Do I die? Who's okay? The first and last, no man works like him. A King Jesus arrives in the middle of the air, no man works like him. He calls the saints from everywhere, no man works like him. For he is King of Kings, he is Lord of Lords. Jesus Christ, the first and last, oh. A King Jesus arrives in the middle of the air, oh. He calls the saints from everywhere. Oh, ride on, King Jesus. No man can hinder thee. Ride on, King Jesus. Ride on, no man can hinder thee.
So much, Brother Addis. It's time now to turn our attention to a theme song, which I believe by now is very familiar to everybody. We are doing it in English now for the last time, then the day after, we'll do it in English and Swahili.
I found a way in Jesus.
Ready? Fine.
I found a way in Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. I found a way in Jesus. He is my way to heaven. I found a way in Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. I found a way in Jesus. He is my way to heaven. No one can stop me now. Nothing can stop me now. No one can stop me now. Since Jesus is my way.
As usual, we'll read one more time, Phil.
I found a way in Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. I found a way in Jesus. He is my way to heaven. I found a way in Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. I found a way in Jesus. He is my way to heaven. No one can stop me now. Nothing can stop me now. No one can stop me now. Since Jesus is my way.
Thank you, Doctor. What an incredibly wonderful evening we have already enjoyed tonight. Thank you for being here. Can't you say amen one more time? Amen. Amen. The music was fantastic. Seeing those children before and then right now a little bit ago, and then the young people on the screen, the features, I'm inspired. I've been blessed. I want to thank you for welcoming us to Mwanza. What a privilege to be here for all of our team to join with our brothers and sisters. The Lord is doing some incredible things. Thank you. All of you out in those downlink sites around the world, you've been sending emails and faxes. I want to tell you, they're not only an encouragement, they are exciting and thrilling. Right here in West Tanzania, they were telling us, you were telling us as you emailed us and called in, that there's a church with 80 regular members, 300 attending the downlink site, another one with 200 members, 500 attending, another with 280 members, 1,000 attending, and that's just being multiplied around and around. And just before I walked onto the stage, just before coming out here, they told me that because there are so many people wanting to come, that the equipment has been purchased and will be erected very soon, next few hours, for 20 more sites. Downlink sites in this area. So invite your friends, invite your loved ones to come and enjoy the blessings that God has been blessing us with each night. And there's so much more to come. I'm glad we're just beginning. Tonight, I want to especially welcome our 28 downlink sites in Eastern Nigeria in the Igbo language. They would say, Ndawu. I hope that was close. That's hello to those of you in Nigeria. We're glad you've joined us. This is an important topic tonight. And as I mentioned to you last night, at the end of this program this evening, we are going to give you an opportunity to make a commitment, a public demonstration of your love to Jesus and your belief in God's Word. And I know that the Holy Spirit will be impressing you as to how you should respond in a few minutes when we come to that point in the evening's program. Man has been on a quest for centuries, looking, hunting, trying to find immortality, hoping that someplace, some way, he would stumble onto something that would give him everlasting life. Now, your television is full of it. They have programs that talk about it all the time. Programs that talk about people that are supposedly immortal. And they talk about people that come back from the dead. And all kinds of wild stuff. Life after death. Near-death experiences. Back in the United States, where many of us come from, you can buy these magazines, and on the cover, there's always someone that's supposedly just come back from a death experience, and now they're alive again. Tonight, we're going to talk about this topic from a biblical perspective. Just exactly where can eternal life be found according to the Bible? Now, some people have resorted to trying to talk to the dead. But if you look at it very carefully, you'll realize that eternal life certainly cannot be found in man. All you've got to do is take a walk through the cemetery, and you become painfully aware that man is not mortal. That he is subject to death. In fact, the scripture says this about it in Genesis, right at the beginning of the Bible, Genesis 3, verse 19. In the sweat of your face you shall eat bread until you return to the ground. For out of you it were taken. For dust you are, the Bible says, and to dust you shall return. So the scripture is absolutely clear that immortality, eternal life, cannot be found in man. It says very, very clearly that you and I are mortal human beings. Job, on the other hand, chapter 4, verse 17, said this: can a mortal man be more righteous than God? Can a man be more pure than his maker? You see, so the scripture refers to you and to me as being mortal. It's a given fact. That means that we are subject to death. Who was it? It was Howard Hughes. Do you know that name here in Africa? Or in Australia? Or in Hungary, or wherever you're watching this tonight? Howard Hughes was one of the richest men who ever lived. Millions upon millions upon millions of dollars through oil industry. And he spent a fortune trying to find immortality. All of the money in the world, and he couldn't find it. He lived the last few years of his life, which wasn't that long ago, in a bacteria-free environment. He spent all that money simply trying not to die, hoping that some way, somehow, somebody would find an answer to this most basic question that mankind has always wanted. But the scripture tells us that only one person has immortality. Over in the New Testament, 1 Timothy 6:15 and 16. He will manifest in his own time. He who is the blessed, the only potentate, the King of kings and Lord of lords, who alone has immortality, dwelling in unapproachable light, whom no man has seen nor can see, to whom be honor and everlasting power. Amen. So it says, only God has immortality. Therefore, it is not going to be found in mankind. Science, dear friends, is not going to find the answer to immortality. What was the joke somebody told me just the other day? Some scientists were talking to God. Did you hear about this? They were talking to God, and they supposedly said, God, we don't need you anymore. Science can do everything that you did. We can clone animals now. Make animals from the DNA so they're the same. We will soon come to a place that we can create people. God, we don't really need you anymore. And according to the story, God said, okay, go ahead, scientist, make somebody. And so they said, well, let's take a little bit of dirt right here. And the Lord said, oh no, go get your own dirt. So science, you see, isn't going to find the answers. It's not going to happen in a test tube, folks. Yet people are continually looking for immortality. Did you know that some of the large cities back in the United States, where I come from, now have companies that actually freeze people when they die? As crazy as it sounds, that's true. You can make arrangements in America so that when you die, your body will be quickly frozen and saved in a safe. And then when the day comes that science has advanced enough, they think, that they will thaw you out and science will be able to bring you back to life. That's what they're freezing bodies for. But friends, I can tell you, science will never be able to do that. In fact, there are hundreds and hundreds of books on the market that tell you that there's different ways you can find eternal life. In fact, in the U.S. again, there was a recent mail out It said, you don't have to die. Well, if that were true, that'd be pretty impressive. It went on to say that immortality was just a short way off. Science, they said, had it figured out. And it wouldn't be long until man would have the chance to live forever. On TV just the other day, they were talking to a woman, and they said, you have found the fountain of youth, right? And this attractive, intelligent woman said, yes, I have. You know, people, there are those who are constantly looking, hoping that some way they're going to find eternal life. But tonight, I want to just simply tell you that the Bible says that eternal life is not going to happen here. Listen carefully to a book way at the back of the Bible, Titus 3:7. That having been justified by His grace, we should become heirs according to the hope of eternal life. What the scripture says is that eternal life is not now, it's future. Hope of eternal life. You hope for something in the future. Luke 18:30 elaborates, who shall not receive many times more in this present time and in the age to come eternal life. So the Bible does not say that in this life you and I are going to receive immortality. It won't happen here. It's off in the future when that's going to happen. Friends, eternal life can be found only in Jesus Christ. And this evening, I want to tell you clearly and without question, you won't find it in Muhammad. You won't find it in Buddha. And you won't find it in Confucius. None of these great leaders offer you eternal life. It can be found only in Jesus Christ. Is that clear to all of you watching in Maiha, East Nigeria? Do you understand that there tonight? How about here in this auditorium, this large stadium? Jesus, speaking to his friend Martha, said in John 11:25, familiar verse to some of you, Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. You see, that life is found only in Him, and there is absolute proof of that. What proof do you have for believing in Jesus Christ? What proof is there that He came up out of that grave? Well, you know, if it was just a statement that had been made in one place by one individual, that would be one thing. But listen to what the scriptures say about the resurrection of Jesus and who saw it. Remember, if it's in the Bible, we believe it. And if it's not, we don't accept it. The Bible says this, Mary Magdalene, she saw him in John 20:10, it's recorded. Then the other women, they are some of those that are referred to in different places recorded in Scripture, where people saw Jesus after his resurrection, found there in Matthew 28:8. Here's another one. Cleopas and the other disciple, it's mentioned, on the road as they walked to Emmaus. These men walked and talked with Jesus after his resurrection, recorded there in Luke 24:13. Then the 11 disciples and others in Luke 24:33, They saw Jesus, and they talked to him. Then the 10 apostles and the others with them when Thomas was absent, recorded in John 20, verse 19. Christ appeared to them, and they talked to him. And then you have doubting Thomas and the other apostles when Jesus showed them the scars in his side and those nail prints in his hand that we have watched every night on the big screen. And that's recorded in John 20, 26. And then you have the seven apostles that talked to him as mentioned in John 21. And again, the disciples in Matthew 28, 16. And he was with the other apostles on the Mount of Olives before he ascended back to heaven, recorded in John 20, 26. And there's another place in Scripture where it says that Jesus was seen by 500 people at one sight. So, friends, it is well documented that Jesus Christ is the one who came up out of the grave and lived on this earth, and then went back to heaven. He arose, and because he arose from the dead, it is he and he alone that can offer us life eternal. Friends, it's found only in Jesus Christ, no other one. 1 John, the back of the Bible, chapter 5, verse 11. And this is the testimony that God has given to us eternal life, and this life in his Son. So tonight, I'm trying to make it very clear to you that life is found only in Jesus Christ. No place else in all the world. The Bible says that man is mortal. John 17:3 records it again. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. A familiar verse. So tonight, I would say to you, if you want eternal life, dear friend, you have to have Jesus Christ. It's as simple as that. You must have Jesus Christ. So how do I receive eternal life? Do I receive it by being good? We talked about that the other night. No, that's not good enough. Do I receive it even if I can keep the Ten Commandments? No. The Bible says clearly there is only one way. John 3:36 goes on and says, he who believes in the Son has everlasting life. And he that believes in the Son, Jesus Christ, has everlasting life. And he who does not believe in the Son of God shall not see life. But the wrath of God abides on him. Now, friends, if that person does not accept Jesus Christ, it is quite clear he will not have eternal life. It only comes through Christ. There we are, right back to Christ again. John 6:47 goes on and says, most assuredly I say to you, he who believes in me has everlasting life. Friends, the message of this whole crusade, this whole series of meetings, is that you must have Jesus Christ. Now that's the next point we will study in a very important way for your understanding of eternal life. This is what it is. How do I keep eternal life after I've accepted it? What do you think the answer is over there in Owerri, East Nigeria? Friends there? Tonight, watching by a satellite, what's the answer? Jesus gives us eternal life, but how are we going to keep it? This is where a lot of people get all mixed up. Unfortunately, even good Christian people get mixed up because they don't know what the Bible says. They don't know how to keep it. They're willing to accept eternal life, but they don't know how to keep it. Let's look at how. Here it is. This is what the scripture says. It's so important. 1 Timothy 6:12. Fight the good fight of faith. Okay? Let's take a little time here. Fight the good fight of, says faith. My willpower. You see, I know people who think that the way you overcome the problems in your life, if you have lots of willpower, you're real strong, and you can do these things, then you're going to keep eternal life. No, dear friends. The Bible says, 1 Timothy 6:12, fight the good fight of faith. You see, it takes place not in our willpower, no matter how determined we are, but by faith in Jesus Christ. Faith in what he can do, not what you are able to do. It is quite obvious what we're able to do, and that's not very much. But what God can do is fantastic. It is tremendous. And so my faith must be in Jesus. Fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life, in which you are also called and have confessed the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. So the scripture tells us that if you want to keep it, you've got to fight the good fight. But it's a fight of faith, not of your willpower. And each day, you must have faith in Jesus Christ. Each day, you have to surrender your life to Jesus Christ. Each day, you have to call on him in the beginning of the morning and say, Jesus, I give you my life. And each day, you have to surrender your will and what you plan for that to Jesus Christ. That's how you fight the good fight of faith. And it won't come any other way. Let's look at another text that helps explain it even farther. Matthew 19:29. Everyone who has left houses or brothers or sisters or fathers or mothers or wife or children or land for my name's sake shall receive 100-fold and inherit eternal life. Now, friends, in order to have eternal life and to keep it, you have to be willing to give Jesus everything. Everything. Be willing to give up even your life, or your father, or your mother, or your brother, or your sister. It requires that you be willing to surrender everything to Jesus. And I know that there's a lady who did that in this giant stadium Friday night. And when she went home that night, she was disowned because of the decision she made at the beginning of this series of meetings. She was turned away from her own family. The Bible knows what it's talking about. But dear friend lady, if you are watching tonight, I want you to know, or if there are others that I don't know about, that Jesus has made provision for you not only on this earth, but for eternal life as well. Now, I want you to know, friends, that are watching tonight outside of the United States, and of course, there are many watching in the United States via satellite as well, but I want you to know that this has touched my family's life. It touched my father's family. When my father's family made a conscious decision to accept Jesus fully and his doctrines that are taught in this Bible, the very doctrines that we will be going over every night of this series, and my father's family decided to be baptized into Jesus' family, his earthly family, totally disowned him. And the neighbors turned against our family. And so I want you to know, folks, dear friends, brothers and sisters, at times we have to be willing to give up everything that we prize, sometimes including our own loved ones. The Bible says that he that leaves father or mother, brother or sister, shall inherit eternal life. Praise God! That should give us eternal joy as well as earthly happiness. So tonight, you have to decide if Jesus Christ is, as the Bible describes it, your pearl of great price. And you might be willing to sell everything for that pearl of great price, if that is what it takes. You see, sometimes you can't have both. You can't have the world and Jesus Christ. You've got to make a decision. Which do you want? Life, eternal life, is found only in Jesus Christ. Now, the flip side of that is, what is the penalty for sin? Now, you need to understand this, because some of these points I'm making are fundamental points, basic to biblical belief. Once you get clear on them, then many other things that we'll talk about will clear up. Let's see then what the penalty for sin is. James 1:15 says, "Then when desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin." I hope you understand this one point. Friends, temptation is not sin. Let me say that again. Temptation is not sin. Remember in the Bible, Jesus was tempted. But when you fondle, when you love that temptation until it finally gives birth, then it is sin. You see, it's what I do with that temptation. Then when desire is conceived, as the Bible says, that's how sin takes place. It gives birth to sin, and sin, when it is full grown, brings forth death. So sin brings forth death. It's talking about right back in the beginning. Remember, we studied that several nights ago, how Adam was responsible for our nature. Romans 5:12 puts it this way: "Therefore, just as through one man sin had entered the world," that's Adam, "and death through sin, and thus death spread to all men, because all have sinned." The Bible goes on and says in Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord." Friends, are you clear on that point tonight? Life is found in Jesus Christ, but the penalty for death, for sin, is death. Read with me what the Bible also says about the penalty for sin. If you can read in English, read it on the big screen. Revelation 21:8. "But the cowardly, unbelieving, abominable, murderers, sexually immoral, sorcerers, idolaters, and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burns with fire and brimstone, which is the second death." Now, the Bible clearly states that the penalty for sin is death. But remember, there are two types of death. Two types. Now, this is talking about the first death or the second death. Which is it? We must be real clear on this, friends. What is the penalty for sin? Well, of course, we will all die because of sin. But watch what the scripture says over in Acts 24, the 15th verse. "I have hope in God that which they themselves also accept, that there will be a resurrection of the dead, both of the just and the unjust. So this first death, the first death that we die, there's a resurrection from. It is for the just and the unjust. So that really can't be the penalty. It's that second death that the Bible says that is the penalty for sin. It's that second death that we're most concerned about. You see, now when people die, that second death, what is that like? Psalm 37:10 makes it very clear. For yet a little while, and the wicked shall be no more. Indeed, you will look carefully for his place, but it shall be no more. Now, folks, I'm sorry, but there's nowhere in this book that it says the wicked can get eternal life in hell. Sorry, that's an impossibility. That's news to some of you watching tonight. You can only get eternal life in Jesus. You can't get eternal life in hell. It's impossible, because life is found only in Jesus Christ. John 5:12 goes on and says this: He that hath the Son hath life. He that hath not the Son hath not life. In other words, the wicked will come to an end. Let's go on. This is new to some of you, so follow me carefully, because it's all in the Bible. Psalm 37:20 says, But the wicked shall perish, and the enemies of the Lord, like the splendor of the meadows, shall vanish into smoke. They shall vanish away. So it says the wicked are simply going to go up in smoke. They're going to vanish away. They're not going to be anymore. 2 Peter 2:12 goes on. But these, like natural brute beasts, made to be caught and destroyed, speak evil of the things they do not understand, and will utterly perish in their own corruption. So the Bible says that the wicked are going to, get that, utterly perish. They're going to be no more. In fact, the scripture goes on, and it says how thorough that destruction of the wicked will be. Nahum, small book, not often quoted, first chapter, verse 9. What do you conspire against the Lord? He will make an utter end of it. Affliction will not rise up the second time. It says the wicked are going to be destroyed. They will utterly perish. They will be no more. Affliction, verse 10, will not rise up the second time. For while they be tangled like thorns, and while drunken like drunkards, they shall be devoured like stubble, fully dried. Now, friends, have you ever seen a stubble field on fire? Now, our family lives in the northwest part, up in the corner of the United States. And the northwest part of the United States has huge wheat fields, acres and acres and acres, miles, kilometers of wheat fields. And in the latter part of May, the farmers cut the wheat, because this is the beginning of summer up there. And they leave the stubble sticking up just about that high. Cut off the wheat, and the stubble's about this high. And it's green when they cut it. But in June, it gets much drier, and it begins to turn color. And by July, about this time of year, it's even more dry, and usually in the month of August, there's no rain in the Northwest. And that stubble field just turns golden brown, and there's no moisture in it. Now, sometimes a passing motorist driving by in an automobile will throw out a cigarette, and it'll start a small fire. But instantly, the whole countryside is in an inferno. You can hear the fire as it roars through those stubble fields. You can smell the fire. You can see the smoke for miles and kilometers. It burns everything there is, and nothing is left. The Bible says that the wicked shall be stubble, fully dried, fully dried. That means there won't be anything left. Malachi chapter 4, verse 1 says it this way: "For behold, the day is coming, burning like an oven, and all the proud, yes, all who do wickedly, will be like what? Be like what? Stubble. And the day which is coming shall burn them up." Now, friends, let me point something out. This scripture does not read this way. Look carefully. "The day which is coming shall burn them." That isn't the way it reads, is it? It has another word there in English, and in your language too. It says, "shall burn them up." It means completely. Do you get this point? Doesn't say they're going to burn. The Bible teaches they're going to burn up completely. Goes on, says the Lord, not the preacher, says the Lord of hosts. Now, how thoroughly is it going to burn them up? Go on with Malachi 4, verse 3 now. "That will leave them neither root nor branch. You shall trample the wicked, for they shall be ashes under the soles of your feet on the day that I do this, says the Lord of hosts." So it says, the wicked are going to be turned into ashes. They will be no more. This is simply what the scripture tells us about them. Matthew 10:28 puts it a different way: "And do not fear those who can kill the body, but cannot kill the soul, but rather fear him who is able to destroy both the soul and the body in hell." Now, another night, we'll talk more about the soul. It's an important topic. But for now, you see, that will be total destruction. The Bible says they are no more. Period. That's it. Now, perhaps some of you, particularly in Europe, have heard of a man by the name of Robert Ingersoll. Robert Ingersoll was an atheist, someone who chooses not to believe and trust in our God. And he wrote in angry letters against God. Many people who knew him, Robert Ingersoll, or knew about him, are surprised to learn that this atheist that wrote so angrily against God once studied to be a gospel minister of Jesus Christ. It's a sad story. When he first started as a minister, he was teamed up with an evangelist. And night after night after night, he would listen to an evangelist preach about the marvelous, the loving grace of Jesus. But then Robert Ingersoll would hear him end the sermon by telling people that if they didn't come forward to accept God's invitation of grace and to be saved, that they were going to go to hell, where they would burn forever and ever. He heard that evangelist preach about tiny little babies in hell whose blood ran through their veins like molten lead, burning them to death, but not quite, just always alive, but in pain, excruciating pain for the wicked. And finally, one night, Robert Ingersoll, the young, budding minister, got up. He walked out of that church building. He looked up toward heaven, and he shook his fist at God. And he said, God, if that's the way you are, I hate you, and I will never serve you. And he became one of the world's most renowned atheists. You see, there are many people who have learned about God through similar experiences because of what they've been taught by pastors or their parents, by friends or even teachers, and they do not understand the wonderful mercy of God when it comes to the subject of hellfire. Many people, again, particularly some of you possibly in Europe, have read works like the Italian Dante's Inferno. He was a Christian writer who describes people being turned upside down in coals of fire while the devil makes his rounds, sticking a red-hot poker against their bare feet. These writers sadly don't understand what the Bible says about hell. And even tonight, many people who desire to let the Bible be their spiritual foundation have a concept of hell that is drawn from a few texts at the neglect of the many, and others even, than those that we studied tonight. This partial understanding about the punishment of the wicked causes people to draw a reprehensible conclusion about God's character of love. Friends, don't you think that God must be saddened when represented falsely in this terrible way? You see, the problem rests, folks, right here. Let me explain where many people have trouble here. Back to Matthew again, 25, verse 46. And these will go away into everlasting punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. You see the word? Everlasting punishment throws people off track. They want to take the words everlasting punishment and say that it means a punishment that goes on and on and on. Follow me closely here because this is critical. The problem is with this word punishment. The effect of the punishment is eternal. Let me say that again. The results of the punishment is eternal. Do you understand that? They're never coming back. They will be no more. The punishment is eternal. But the punishing is not eternal. What that says is that everlasting punishment, it does not say everlasting lasting punishing. What it means is that they're going to be destroyed. They're going to be no more. It does not mean that fire is going to go on and on and on, and they will be tortured throughout eternity. No, it does not mean that. Now there's a text in Matthew, the 30th verse, where it says that if your hand offends you, cut it off. Wow, that's strong. It's better to enter into eternal life lame than to be cast into hell where the worm dies not and the fire is not quenched. And some people tell us that that must mean that the wicked are going to burn in hell for eternity and that the worms are going to eat and chew on them throughout eternity and never get anywhere. But again, thankfully, that's not what the Bible is saying. One more study in the Word. The word for hell there is the word called Gehenna. The original language, Gehenna. It was a place right outside the city of Jerusalem where Jesus once lived. And that was like their big garbage dump. They threw their dead animals on that hump. They threw the garbage out there. And what the worms didn't eat, the fire came along and burned. It meant total destruction. That's what Christ was talking about, where they would be totally destroyed. It did not mean that those animals were going to burn on and on in that pile forever and ever. Now, perhaps you've read about the towns in the Bible by the name of Sodom and Gomorrah. Let's read what the scripture has to say about these two fairly well-known towns. It tells us that God sent some angels there, and they tried to get Lot and his family to get out of the city because it was going to be destroyed. And you remember that story, maybe, that finally they had to take them, the angels did, by the hand and lead them out of the city. And even then, Lot's wife didn't make it because she turned back and was destroyed. Now let's read what the scripture says about it. Jude again, verse 1, verse 7, near the end of the Bible. As Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities around them is similar manner to these, having given themselves over to sexual immorality and gone after strange flesh, are set forth as an example, suffering the vengeance of eternal fire. Oh, there's that word again, eternal fire. Now, friends, let me ask you tonight, are Sodom and Gomorrah someplace in the world still burning today? No. It meant the fire burned them up. They were never coming back. The destruction was eternal. The punishment was eternal, but it didn't mean the fire was going to go on and on and on and never go out. So when will the destruction take place? A big question is this. Are there people burning in hell right now? 1 Thessalonians 1:10, and to wait for his son from heaven, whom he raised up from the dead, even Jesus, who delivered us from the wrath to come. Wrath to come. It doesn't say now. It says the wrath to come. When is that going to happen? Jesus says in Matthew 13:40, Christ talking, therefore, as the tares are gathered and burned in this fire, so it will be at the end of this age. It's going to happen at the end of time. The end of this age. That does not mean it's going on now. There is no one burning in hell now. It will happen at the end of time. This is a text, folks, you will need to listen to very carefully because the scripture makes it crystal clear. It's in Job, back in the middle of the Bible, chapter 21, verse 30. for the wicked are reserved for the day of doom. Listen carefully. The wicked are reserved for the day of doom. That means they die. They shall be brought out on the day of wrath. Listen, verse 31. Who condemns his way to his face and who repays him for what he has done. Verse 32. Yet he shall be brought to the grave and a vigil kept over the tomb. God says that the wicked person, they will be brought forth from the tomb. And it even says that a vigil will be kept over the tomb, that they will pay for what they have done. But it's to come. It's not now. It's in the future. Now the Bible describes it in these words. 2 Peter, back in the back of the Bible again, 3 verse 10. But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens will pass away with a great noise, and the elements will melt with fervent heat. Both the earth and the works that are in it will be burned up. The Bible says that at the end of time, the whole world is going to be burned up, and the wicked are going to be burned up with it. And that will be the end of sin. They will be no more. Sin and sinners will be no more. Never, never, ever again. Let me just explain. God takes no pleasure, folks, in the punishment or the destruction of the wicked. None at all. That's not what God wants. In fact, he says in Ezekiel, say to them, as I live, says the Lord God, I have no pleasure in the death of the wicked, but that the wicked turn from his way. God doesn't want you to miss eternal life, friends. God wants you to have eternal life. He offers it to you completely free of charge. Do you understand? All you have to do is accept what Jesus has done for you. Accept him into your heart as your Savior, and he will give you eternal life. That's the promise that he makes to you tonight. But that the wicked turn from his way and live. Turn from your evil ways is what the Bible says. And why should you die? You don't have to. You don't have to miss eternal life. You can have eternal life, friend. God says, I don't have any pleasure in the death of the wicked. And the opposite of life is death. Make that very clear. And you won't have any trouble understanding this study here, friend. Life is found in Christ. Without Christ, there is no life. The penalty for sin is death. 1 John, we quoted it before, 5 verse 12. He who has the Son has life. He who does not have the Son of God does not have life. Isn't it wonderful that there needs to be no confusion over the subject of what's going to happen to the wicked? Friend, God is kind. God is merciful. God is long-suffering. He's not going to punish people throughout eternity. No, he says that life is found in him. That whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. That's where life is. It is in Jesus Christ. Tonight, friends, I hope that you will make the decision to take Christ into your life, to have life. You don't have to die. You can have life eternal in Jesus Christ. Won't you accept him right now and give him your heart? Listen, as Walter Ortiz sings,
just as I am and waiting not, just as I am without one.
There's a pastor or a lay leader that is standing near the front of your meeting place. They are standing there tonight because they want to be there to welcome you as you accept Christ. As I mentioned last night, and as I mentioned at the beginning of our service tonight, we're going to give you an opportunity to accept Jesus publicly into your life. Now tonight, this may be the very first time that you have ever been confronted with a decision about eternal life. There are people here in this giant stadium that have heard something totally new tonight. And there are thousands of people around the world that are saying, that is good news. I can hardly believe it, but it must be true. And friends, it is true. It is absolutely true. Tonight, I am going to ask you to publicly acknowledge your acceptance of Jesus Christ. And I'm going to ask you to do it like this. Tonight, if you want to accept Jesus Christ into your life, now listen carefully, if you want to accept Jesus Christ into your life for the very first time or for the fifth or tenth or 100th time, but this message tonight has touched your heart and you say, I want to accept Jesus into my life the first time or again, then I want you to stand to your feet right now. Whether you're here in this giant stadium with thousands of other people, if you accept Jesus into your life tonight for the first time or again, stand to your feet right now. Stand if you want to accept Jesus Christ into your life. Don't sit there. Jesus is saying, if you want to have eternal life, brother, sister, father, mother, young person, stand to your feet and accept Jesus as your Savior. Friend out there watching in satellite land, watching on that screen, I'm speaking to you right now as I look at this television camera. Jesus is talking to your heart. You felt him in your life in a way that you have never felt before. And it's been clear because the Holy Spirit has spoken to your heart. And I want to invite you with everything that I can possibly say and every prayer that I can offer that tonight you will make the decision of your eternal life. Don't sit there. The devil wants you to sit there. Jesus wants you to stand and accept him publicly into your life. And I want to encourage you, friend, don't let anything, wealth or houses or lands or even family, stop you from accepting Jesus Christ into your life tonight, because you can have eternal life with him forever and ever. Now our stations out there around the world are going to need to phase out in a few moments. And there will be leaders there on your site, ready and waiting to talk to you that have stood tonight. I want to encourage you, before we sign off with you, make sure that you come back tomorrow night, because we have an incredibly important presentation for you. Now, in some of the downlink sites, there may not be a meeting on Thursday night. In this location, there will be one. But then Friday night is the next regular meeting. Friday night, the next regular meeting. I want to encourage you to be there. But now, friends, I want to talk to those that are in this stadium tonight, specifically. Those that are right here inside these huge lights. I want to talk to you tonight because there's one more call that we want to make. Down on the track, all the way around the track, are church leaders who are waiting for you to come forward if, listen to me right now, if you have been studying and are planning to be baptized into the family of God, then we are inviting you tonight in this giant stadium to come down from where you're standing right now, come down through those stairs and those gates, and to come forward down to this great opening that has been created right here, and I will be waiting for you. It's a big stadium, way out there. It's going to take a few minutes, but I want to invite you right now. Father, back there, way back there, take your family and come down to the front. Mother, with your children, if God has spoken to you and you have been preparing for the decision of your life, I invite you to make your way right now, right down that path, round the track, and there will be leaders prepared to bring you down to the front. Young person, wherever you are in this giant coliseum, as you hear Walter Ortiz sing, start making your way down. Yes, God bless you. You're coming around this great stadium. Come, we will wait. We will wait for you. Start coming right now and join those that are already making their way as Pastor Ortiz sings.
Just as I am, thou wilt receive, will welcome pardon, cleanse, relief, because thy promise I believe, O Lamb of God, I come.
And I'm looking forward to seeing you then, Friday night. How can I start over? No matter what you have done in life, no matter what your largest sin, come Friday night, and the Lord will tell you how you can start over. Right now in this giant stadium, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people are coming forward because they made a decision to be baptized to accept Jesus Christ as their Savior for eternity so that they can live forever. Good night to those of you in our satellite land.